I guess. So we can go to the next slide. The problem here is that all of these creationist arguments, and I used to make them all, so I know the arguments. They're perfectly good reasons if you already believe. If you don't, they are not convincing reasons. And the reason for this is that these are all what we call God of the gaps arguments. You scientists can't explain blank, X, whatever, therefore there must be a God. This is along the lines of the famous Sidney Harris cartoon. These two scientists, the one says, I think you should be more explicit here in step two, and the step two there is, and then a miracle occurs. You can't, it's just a word. A miracle is just a word for something we can't explain. I don't know how that happened. It must have been a miracle. Next slide. For example, just 2 weeks ago, I went to Clearwater, Florida. There is there a very famous, at least in Florida, a Virgin Mary appearance. It's a huge icon. The thing sits about 40 feet tall. The local Christian church bought the bank building. It's on the side of a bank building. They bought the bank building, cost them $10 million to preserve this, which they consider to be a miracle. Next slide. You can see people going there in crutches and wheelchairs. This was about 6 years ago when it first appeared. Today, here's somebody in a wheelchair. They've put up a huge crucifix here. You can see the size of this thing. Next slide. Turns out, this is myself and the amazing Randy, Richard Dawkins, standing in front of a bunch of candles here. There's so much wax from the candles, they had to put down that stuff they put in auto shops to soak up oil. There's so many people there praying to this miracle. Next slide. But in fact, if you walk around, you find out wherever there's a sprinkler head, there's a miracle of this mineral water spray that appears on the windows. Next slide. In fact, on the backside, there's another Virgin Mary that somebody began to wipe off. This used to be there about 5 years ago, so I'm not sure why the church wiped this off, but you can see the miracle beginning to appear. There's another Virgin Mary here, yours truly here. Next slide. In fact, the question is it really a miracle of Mary, or is it a miracle of Marge? Well, thank you. I appreciate the... As Kyle said in his many thoughtful comments, we are pattern-seeking, storytelling animals. We tend to see what we're looking for. We see what we want to find. Now, I can't teach my entire course in evolutionary theory in 10 more minutes, so what I want to do is just leave you with one deep message with a couple of examples of this, and that is, even if I can't explain it, I can explain the Virgin Mary thing. It's mineral water spray. There used to be a palm tree there, and spray and left it there, and they cut the palm tree down so people could see it. Okay, no big deal. I trust you're not putting your faith and your religion based on icons like that. But what about these other things? I claim that it's the same principle. That is, Kyle brought up the fine-tune problem. That is the fact that there's all these different anthropic adjustments. The universe is structured in such a way, it's just so carefully balanced. If it wasn't this way, it's not that we wouldn't be here, but there'd be some other species, or it'd be something like from Star Trek, you know, where you get these people with two eyes and gnarly things on their forehead, and they speak English with a Klingon accent, wherever they speak English with a Klingon accent in the universe. It's that nothing would exist. And so you have all these different, the electrical force between a proton and electron, and the Planck constant times the speed of light, and Newton's gravitational constant, G, and they have dozens of these. These are all real examples. These aren't just made up by an apologist, and I'm going to get up there and tell you these constants aren't real, or that the universe is not fine-tuned. It is. Next slide. Question is, why is it fine-tuned, and what are we to make of this? Well, there's several different answers, half a dozen different answers to this. But even if I can't answer it at all, or even if I'm wrong, that doesn't mean God did it. It just means it's a mystery. We don't know what it is. This is the principle I want you to take home tonight, just the one thing. For example, in the 17th century, there was what was called the plane problem. Newton identified, after his theory of gravity was published, that there is this weird phenomenon in the solar system. All the planets are in a plane. They're in the same plane of the ecliptic, it's called. They're not like this and so on. They're all in a plane, except for weird Pluto, which is probably just an errant moon. So for Newton, the explanation is God did it. That's the way God set up the solar system. Nobody makes that argument today, because we now know exactly why the planets are all in a plane. It has to do with clouds of gas condensing into stars. So the problem is of hitching your faith to some scientific argument about fine-tunedness or some weird anomaly that scientists can't yet explain. What are you going to do with your faith when we come up with an explanation? Next slide. So for example, here's another answer to the fine-tuned problem. Maybe our universe is not the only universe. Maybe there's multiple bubble universes, lots of universes. Stephen Hawking suggests, in fact, that quantum fluctuations lead to the spontaneous creation of teeny universes out of nothing. And he means nothing. Most of the universes collapse to nothing, but a few will reach critical size, will expand in an inflationary manner, and will form galaxies and stars and maybe beings like us. Most of them don't. If they exist, we don't know that they exist. This is mathematically possible. We're still trying to collect data on this. Next slide. The latest issue of Scientific American just came out last week, has a whole issue devoted to this very subject. It's no longer science fiction. Now, cosmologists are beginning to devise ways to test, empirically test, to find out if there are other universes other than our own. So, in summary, if each of these different bubble universes, and there may be an infinite number of them, all have slightly different laws of nature, slightly different fine-tuned, not-so-fine-tuned, terribly tuned for life, and so on, all the ones that are terribly tuned and not-so-fine-tuned won't give rise to life. Any of them that are like ours, and if there's enough of them, and if there's an infinite number of them, that's enough, any of them that are like ours may give rise to sentient beings like us who ask the question, where did we come from? That's one answer. It may be wrong, but if it's wrong, it doesn't make the God hypothesis right. It just means we don't know yet. Next slide. So, continuing on the design thing. The question is, what made the whale's flipper? This is just one of hundreds of examples I could use. The whale's flipper has this pretty nifty design for cutting through the water. The whole body of the whale is a fusiform body. The head doesn't have a neck and shoulders. You know, they just all blend together for cruising through the water. It's hydrodynamic instead of aerodynamic. But if you actually take the skin off, you see what the flipper looks like. It looks like your arm. Now, why would an intelligent designer design a not-so-intelligently looking flipper? In fact, it looks like our flipper, except we don't have a flipper, we have an arm. The answer is because a top-down designer didn't build it. A bottom-up tinkerer called evolution did. Next slide. So, for example, if humans were designed by God, we might look something like this. To alleviate the lower back problems we have, more vertebrate that are thicker. To alleviate the problems of blood flow in the legs and blood collection in the legs, you have stronger veins and more valves. You have a much larger buttock muscles here to hold this upper thing. Your ears would be slightly different, and so on. The arms would be shorter. The rib cage would be larger to hold the organs. The point is this. Yes, it looks like design has happened, but is it really intelligent design? Does it look like a omniscient, omnipotent being really made us with all the little flaws in our design? Next slide. Another question, evolution or God or intelligent designer. We have two different hypotheses here. Dr. Hovind, God, and Kyle, intelligent designer, id, whoever id is. The question is like, let's just say, let's take this one sequence of the evolution of the ceratopsians, like the triceratops, the most famous, the little three-horned dinosaur, triceratops. Where'd it come from? Okay, regardless of whether the picture is right or not, it's roughly right, because we have quite a few fossils here. When did id, or God, interject his influence? Did he just create the general form and then evolution created all the other forms?